pounds, and you're gonna go and put these. Don't get me started on vaccines. Oh my god. I mean, I look at it like a vaccine. You don't know what the fuck's in a pro hormone. Besides, human growth hormone is already increased through. How ironic that not only all you gotta do is nothing, literally, all you gotta do is intermittent fast, and theoretically, you'll get your benefits. Isn't that ironic, right? How fasting more can help you build bigger muscles in the long run. Now, I haven't proven that because you see, I haven't been too dedicated and I've been doing so much botanical stuff this summer and I had other interests and I told you, dude, you know, working out isn't my, I enjoy it, but there's so many other things, especially that it's like I'm not neglecting it, but I don't know, you see me come in 20 minutes sometimes and that's all I got or that's all, or just having the car or the condition, but you know what I mean? I'm not obsessed. I know you're not obsessed either. You just do it throughout the day, you work. If you're working, then you'll do it and you enjoy it, and sometimes you go harder than others, but you know that you have a lifetime. And all these young kids, and all these young kids, they start off like they want to get big so fast. Like, why not get big in a slow way, in a natural way, through healthy body? Natural, not only naturally, slowly do it, build muscles that are not only strong through calisthenics, through these things we've been doing, and but also build them through healthy nutrition. And then it's like, cleanse your body, then literally build from the ground up, like these fat dudes. No, it's not even a mean way. These fat dudes, they think that you can just like convert the fat to muscle. Now maybe you sort of can, but it doesn't quite work that way. Like, you can't just shortcut. These guys need to do more cardio. They gotta drink their water and drink all their and eat their fruits and vegetables to slim their system, to cut the mucus and cut the toxins, to lose the weight and then get skinny. They need to get super skinny before getting super ripped. But these guys are trying to get from fat to like, what's that called? Like what's that called? Half fat? What do they call that? Skinny fat? These dudes are trying to go from like fat to skinny fat to like, to I don't, you know what I mean? I don't know. I'm saying, if they did this vegan regimen, if they included some fasting, and really, I know I'm not doing it myself now, but if they ate like mostly produce, if they gone into these levels, they would clean their bodies up, feel great, and then they could be building strong muscle from very healthy matter, from very healthy material, like vegetables and fruits. Dude, the word vegetable itself means strong. You know that? The etymology of vegetable.
I did not know that. In what language?
I think it must be Italian, because not Latin, or no, Latin as well. Vegeta, think of Vegeta.
You know where Latin comes from? It's a dialect from ancient Sumerian.
Yes, it all goes, is it? It's from the they call them.
Latin, call the, Arabic, and
yeah, Aramaic,
ancient
Aramaic,
Sanskrit,
Syriac,
ancient no, Sanskrit. Phoenician, they're all dialects. Phoenician. Of
from
ancient
Indo,
Sumerian.
From the Indo-European.
Fred, this is your mission. If you can find the first language, I will give you like $100.
Yo.
Like, literally, the first language is the most powerful language in the world, and it's so like when I'm doing like spiritual rituals. Yes, vibrationally, it's the most powerful thing in the world. Everything's made up of energy, vibrations, and frequencies.
But dude, I don't think there could be a first language, because what was going on in America?
You know, the first language, yes, it's numbers, zeros and ones. Binary, technically,
binary, yep.
Is the first language, but the first language on Earth is what I mean.
No, I know, but Shiga, think of it logically this way. There were no Indo-Europeans in fucking America, in ancient, the New World, you know, North and South America. They had the Native Americans, Massachusetts, Algonquin, Connecticut, Nipmuc, Adirondack. These were all their own language. They had their own, there was no, we don't think of like ancient Native American languages as epic or whatever, but obviously it worked for them. And I think it's beautiful because Massachusetts, place of many hills, Connecticut, where the rivers meet, Adirondack, people who eat from the trees. What else? So many examples. Dakota. Dakota means friend. Dakota. That's going in the more western area. California has native languages. Montauk, Potts. Dude, where you used to live in Virginia, North Carolinas, those are the Cherokees, right? In El Paso, New Mexico, they're called the Chayo. What are they called? The fucking... I forgot. But I'm saying, there's an ancestral language. You know how many languages are on the planet? If we're not even talking modern ones, you know how many languages are extinct? You know how many languages are going extinct because they're only spoken in like Brazil? You got like shamanic, you got languages that are just in one little remote area, and through cultural assimilation, that's why there's, thank God there's still people teaching ancient languages. There's a place, dude, speaking of Sumer, well, there's a place in Syria, they still teach biblical Aramaic. Dude, and look at all the Hebrews. Wait till you see how many kinds of Hebrews there are. There's a Spanish Hebrew called Ladino. Ladino, there's a Palestinian Arabic, there's a Palestinian Hebrew, which is an oxymoron because they're fucking beefing with each other. It's all bullshit. Then there's also Syriac, there's Syriac, which is a Syrian ancient language. Then there's also Amharic, not to be confused with Aramaic. Amharic is like what was spoken in Ethiopia.
All right, let's take a step back from the languages and let's go back to the plants. I want to learn about sugarcane.
Okay. Steroid.
I want to learn about sugarcane. So,
sugarcane. Oh, yeah, that's what I hung up on. What's the last thing? Okay, wait, let me read this thing. Let's read this random thing about plant sterol. Plant sterolin. So think of it this way. We don't need no... Plant sterolin facilitates building immune cells by donating its colloidal nutrient. Steroids aid, listen to this, steroids aid, and no, he's not talking those, of course, steroids aid in binding antigen protein, which I don't know what that is.
You know
antigen.
What I learned the other day?
Huh?
You know what I learned the other day?
The other day? What?
You gotta get an AIDS test before you go to Russia because they don't want people with AIDS in their country.
My country?
Yeah.
Technically? They don't want people with AIDS. Dude, AIDS... AIDS, I'm pretty, I know I shouldn't say this because I don't, AIDS, I'm pretty sure you can eliminate with very powerful antimicrobials such as oregano. I'm pretty sure if you consume enough oregano oil and build a healthy microbiome and my friend Salvador, the same two talks about, I'll send you the guy, Dr. Robert Morris. This guy, and actually the black doctor, Dr. Sebi, have you heard of him yet, Dr. Sebi? Maybe you've come across him once, right? Maybe. Dr. Sebi. Anyway, Dr. Sebi reported to quote-unquote cure AIDS back in 19-something like that. These people can't say they cured this because they just, it's illegal. There's an illegality between natural
doctors. It's like saying
doctors.
You can't say you can't cure cancer even
yes.
though that you can.
Even though you can, exactly, because the business of it, the freaking, people don't take that, like, it's just, it's such a... Like people
it's
have
so
to watch
offensive
out.
Because people don't want to wake up and smell the fucking coffee.
The coffee. Well, don't drink the coffee because that's perfect.
Well, like actually, the healthy coffee. Fred.
I know.
You can drink
dude,
the healthy
just,
coffee.
I'm just especially passionate.
You can
cause,
drink
dude, it's
the
like...
broccoli coffee, Fred.
Broccoli? What?
Broccoli. There's the chemical in it is a natural coffee. If you
is
eat
it?
Your broccoli sprouts.
Oh! You're talking about odorous. I know what you're talking
it
about.
Starts
it has
with
a
S.
POS, yeah, POS or something, right? Polio, I know what you're talking about, yeah. I don't, no, dude, I told you chocolate has a trace amount of caffeine and theobromine, and I'm a big chocoholic,
cacao
you know?
Or chocolate?
Huh?
Cacao plant?
Yes, cacao, you know, dude, I've been eating so much, dude, I eat so much cacao, like, not like, I mean, I'm like, have I let you try the Taza chocolate, which is the Mexican-style chocolate, which is stone ground as well? By the way, and now in your messages to me, what did you mean by teach you how to make butters? What butters are you talking about? To
it's
make
like
hickory nut
from your processor, like grinding it up.
Yes. Well, what I'm gonna do when I finally do it, is once I crack enough hickories, well, here's what I do when I make all my nut butters. I put them in the food processor, turn the nuts into flour. First step, like make it into a fine flour texture. Then I slowly put that flour into my stone grinder. Then many hours later, many hours later, not many, but 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 hours later, lo and behold, so as they say, and then you start to get the smooth, super smooth cream that comes out. Dude,
do you put any probiotics in there?
That would be if I wanted to make cheese. That'd be a great idea to do that in the grinder, but I wouldn't do it that way because that's going to deal with too much, dude, We gotta set up a date where I gotta teach you how to make. We can expect there's so many incredible. Seriously, dude, vegan cheeses, they're already the future. But there's so much creative things you can make. You can make so many textures with so many kinds of cheeses, ingredients. There's so many variables. Like vegan cheese is definitely gonna. When I'm excited, Jacob, my ego is excited not only to make the first hickory nut butters, which hopefully some people in the Y will buy, but I gotta finally get to work and do that instead of just saying that because I'm not even have enough. But you know, I have 2,000 of those nuts. But what I'm excited for is being the first person, I believe, to ever make maybe, unless some really savvy vegan down in like North Carolina or Georgia or even fucking Connecticut or even in any place where hickories grow, unless some really savvy vegan has thought about, hey, let me try to make hickory cheese because I have enough. I'll admit, I'll be a little upset. I'll be like, shit, that was my idea. But making a raw vegan hickory cheese, I'm gonna see how it comes out. I don't think many people have made. You've never heard of a pecan cheese, right? But it's possible. Think of it. Cashews are just the most common because it's the creamy consistency. By the way, what's it called? Like, there's, yeah, because most vegan cheeses are pretty processed, and unfortunately, even the vegan pizzas. Like, dude, I've been eating the whole food vegan pizzas. I'll get you one. It's off the chain. It's amazing. It's just, it's not. They're not doing it right. They're not using organic. They're using organic flour, but like, it's not. Is they're still kind of cutting corners. Even get it, pizza? Get it, pizza? Mm. Cutting corners, yeah, get it. They're cutting corners with
the ingredients. That was cheesy, Fred. That was cheesy. Get it?
What? Say it again?
It was cheesy. That joke was cheesy.
Yeah, vegan cheesy. Yeah, vegan cheesy. Yeah, the Divya. Oh, hey. So that's you kind of playing along. Corner and cheese, they're both dealing with the pizza, yeah. Dude, I'd like, one day we're gonna make a pizza together with sprouted flour, organic, we're gonna use a nice, dude, I once made a feta, whatever you want to, I once made a feta that was off the chain with cashews and macadamia. Wait till you see what happens when you put macadamia nuts. Now, macadamia is an extremely expensive nut. I only fucks with the raw, of course, and organic ones. Most of them come from Africa. You know, macadamia is one of the few native nuts of Australia. I just reminded myself, there's two species of, and they were named after a guy named McAdam. McAdams, can you believe it? This guy named, dude, if you look at my Facebook, I have a tour of my mini fridge. I did a video. Why don't you, have you looked at any of my videos? I got my piano playing. I got my fucking, I got all kinds of shit. I got on freestyle. On Facebook, yeah, if you click on the first video, start scrolling either on your phone, they'll all appear. It's all the stuff I'm still going to hopefully upload on YouTube, even though the quality will be compromised. But I got all my little things. Basically, I did a tour of my mini fridge like a couple of days after I did that long 8-day fast. And then I just did a video I had all the goods in there. I had watermelon, sugarcane. Now I'm going to show you which is the soy sauce. One of these days, I'm going to make a vegan sushi. If I find some good cucumbers, I'm going to do cucumber avocado roll. I want to teach you how to make. I know you've already like learned a little bit. You've seen some recipes. I mean, there's so many recipes, so many, like, it's overwhelming, really. But this will inspire me to go back to cooking anyway, because I'm not going to lie, man. I haven't been the chef that I tell myself I am. I'm obviously an amateur chef, but I do tell myself, and I tell people, like, you know, I am a pretty good chef. Like, I'm not amazing, but I do make some pretty good grub. And it's like I know my spices, you know, I know the ratios, like, I'm pretty good with, I got pretty good taste, especially since becoming vegetarian, vegan, trying so many unique foods that I didn't think I would try because of being picky, all before I get into organic food in general, and then that whole culture and the movement, and, like, I would never think, I used to be scared to eat red bell peppers. What the fuck was I thinking when I was little? Red bell peppers? I was scared of them? Mm-hmm. That's called being a picky when you're a kid. See, some people never grow out of that. Unfortunately, some people don't grow out of it.
Well, now I'm very picky. Now everyone considers me very picky because I won't eat meat and candy and just shit. They say I'm a picky eater because I don't eat cheese and crap and
fucking. That doesn't make you picky. There's a difference between avoiding foods for health and for ethics compared to, you'd be picky if you, like, didn't eat a lot of it, if you were for whatever reason. But I'm not gonna lie, I know you kind of have your own thing, but I just wish you weren't so stubborn about the persimmon, because you would have loved it as much as the others. It's this caramel, speaking of candy, I mean, I just, dude, I'm so passionate about persimmons. Sometimes I think I love the persimmon even more than the pawpaw, but no, it's a pretty close one. But dude, the turtle, wild turkeys eat persimmon. Fucking, that's how badass is that? You know, Thanksgiving is over now. We're on Christmas now. We're about to have New Year. Fucking, and I gotta stop saying fucking. You having me say it, goddamn. But the turkeys, I'll never forget. Dude, the wild turkey. You know, wild turkeys eat all the American foods, for sure. Of course, it's an American bird. Of course, wild turkeys are gonna be eating hickories. I've read articles, and it says that wild turkeys' diet consists, they'll eat everything, like a turkey.
I literally want to grow my own farm just so I can have, like,
the whole variety of everything. You can bring the animals.
No, just so I can have animals that have a happy life and live happily.
Jacob, because that's what we're going to try to do. We can help contribute to bringing back Eden. That's what it is.
And our animals would help our plants, too.
Exactly. Yes, you know, my friend, you got to meet my friend, Ron. He actually helped inspire a lot of my, but not inspire. Well, no, yes, inspire, but he knew a lot about botany, and then we became friends through my other old friend Michael. That's another story. But actually, that actually, okay, I digress. But he check this out. He calls lambs and sheep lambscapers. Get it? Instead of landscapers?
Yes,
because the landscaper, because the sheep / goats are gonna be walking around and they fucking eat, like they eat, you know, they eat the grass, they keep it. Yeah, dude, by not killing. Think about it. In a world of abundance, if you envision abundance, just imagine, I know you don't got much land and I don't either yet or whatever. Imagine having such an abundance of both wild fruits and plants and all exotics. And imagine having so much food and fruits that not only you can feed you, your family, your folks, your neighbors, but like you could literally not even like organic farms. Like the sad thing is modern agriculture, even organic, they still have to do bad things to the land. They still have to spray, like you said, organic. Or no, like I said, organic pesticides. There's still all these loopholes. They still have to destroy, not destroy, but these. It's still better than obviously growing meat. Like obviously, a grove of oranges is way better for the environment than just destroying a bunch of land just for cows to graze, which you're gonna kill. But in a utopia, and if you think of it, Garden of Eden, right? Just like I said about me and the deer eating the persimmons together. Which is like a beautiful utopia. Like that's a vision of utopia right there. The deer's favorite fruit is the persimmon when it can get it, which is only in the fall, which is when people hunt them, sadly, because they know that. And I'm saying, imagine having so much persimmons, because organic farmers, or any farmer, the reason they spray their crops is because the animals fucking go and want to eat them too. And it's like, but check this out. When you grow tough plants, what I've read about this, when you look for these wild plants, like they're resilient, like they don't need watering, they don't need sprays, they don't need anything. Like when you know where you're growing. Now dude, I've just began my farming, so I shouldn't be talking, but from what I've read, the people I've talked to, videos I've met, people, dude, I was in an eco village in Costa Rica. That's where I met that kid Salvador, who learned from the guy who heals people with the fruit diet. We met at a fruit festival. That's the kid that lives in El Paso. Remember how I was in El Paso this spring? Mm-hmm. Last spring? Yeah, from March. So that kid, Irving, we met in Costa Rica in an eco village. This place had fucking fruits growing everywhere, right in front of everybody's ears. Like, there's just chocolate growing, chocolate. Just imagine you walk in and it's like a cacao. I saw my first cacao plant just right next to my face. In fact, I woke up, every day I would wake up next to a cacao plant outside in this bamboo built thing. Dude, you would have loved it. You would have loved this place. I mean, it's an eco village. They have a big, there's another big festival in Costa Rica called the Envision Festival. You can look that up, all kinds of like quote unquote hippie, as well as like just the people that, you know, I don't know, it's in a different place in Costa Rica. But what's great about Costa Rica, man, is Costa Rica's really become a haven for ecological, and do you know what ecological means? You don't need to ask me. Ica is not only a biodiverse paradise, but it has a very progressive policy. I mean, there is a subway, I'm not gonna lie. I mean, I was standing outside of a subway on my last day in Costa Rica. We were standing outside of a subway waiting for this kid. Dude, there's still a dude on my Facebook. If you do some creeping on my profile, god damn, I'm telling you to. There's a kid who, I'm encouraging you to, you heard? Hello?
Yeah, I heard you.
We gotta hang up soon, I know, keep saying. There's a kid who always comments on my shit named Santiago. And his last name is just shortened to MRD. This kid teaches people all throughout Costa Rica permaculture, and that's what I'm doing, permaculture. And that's what you'll be doing, basically. Permaculture is basically a food forest design where you're making food. Permaculture is a portmanteau, which means two words put together like smog, smoke and fog. Permaculture stands for permanent agriculture. Like the fruit tree, you plant the fruit tree, okay, you're pretty much all set for life. You know what I mean? So then permaculture design teaches you what to plant, where to plant, and it's like everything follows an order where you don't need to do anything. And most people are really successful in it. It's really easy to do. People, basically, there's even, Jacob, should I send you the link on this? I haven't even looked this much up yet, but that kid Ron, one of my friends, good friends, he says that there's actually a place that teaches permaculture certification all the way near Greylock. Yeah. You know what another beautiful hidden gem that's right near Greylock is? It's called Kripala. It's not just a yoga studio, it's like renowned in the country with all kinds of guest speakers. They have apparently served the most incredible vegetarian food. There's a gift shop that sells all kinds of unique things. It's a yoga studio. People teach yoga there. They get their certifications. They have, I'm sure they have Tai Chi, all kinds of Eastern related arts. They have guest speakers in the holistic world from all around the world. And it's all the way, it's 2 hours from here, or where is it? Wherever Greylock is. It's in a town called, it's all the way in the border of Mass, deep, deep Western Mass. I'm just so inspired by everything, man. Like, you can't just, like, I'm bringing it up to you because why? Because I saw, because the, oh yeah, because the permaculture village, we basically have an eco village in Mass already. When I see eco village, basically this place in Costa Rica, they don't use any, they have no electricity. Their only electricity they have is what run through a generator. They don't waste anything there. This is the first place where I discovered a compost toilet. You know what they called it? Humanure. You know how intelligent this was designed? You take a shit in this place, you drop the wood chips, believe it or not, it doesn't smell. You take a shit, you drop the wood chips, and you go about. And what's crazy is, I had a lot of fear. I couldn't take my first shit for 4 days being in Costa Rica. I never had that before. 4 days, even in my biggest days of eating meat and cheese and all kinds of chocolate milk, I never had digestion that, not that bad, but I couldn't take a shit for 4 days. And the dude was like, Freddy, you gotta take care of that soon. I'm like, I know. This kid from Queens, ironically. This kid from Queens, Flushing, New York City.
And what was the cause of it?
I had no idea. It was fine after, but like, I couldn't shit from the first day. I was starting to worry because we got to San Jose, Costa Rica, which is the capital. We met with everyone. Dude, this felt unreal. Like, I've seen some of these people on you, like the people I met over there. I didn't think I would meet them in real life. It's not like that they're celebrities, but a lot of these people had YouTube channels, and they were all saying, like, Fred, they all wanted me to be on their, like, dude, you know what's, I'm so thankful for all the people I've met on my trips. From El Paso, where I met, from Costa Rica, from El Paso, where I hung out with Salvador, where I lived with his girlfriend for a month, that was back in March, all the way back in Israel. You know the people that came up with my rap name? Or, like, that happened in Israel. Fred Science, the kids who came up with Fred Science on the bus when we were in the fucking Dead Sea. Remember the Dead Sea Scrolls?
Mm-hmm.
Speaking of the languages, they came up with Fred Science because I was rapping on the bus and they kept asking me to rap and I had so much fun and the vibes were so nice and they're like, Fred Science, I don't know how or who came up with that. Like, they just said Fred Science and it stuck with me so much that here I am referring to myself as Fred Science now just to pay homage as well as I love it so much. You know, I'm not, you know, it's like, someone would be tripping to say that I'm not a scientific kid. Again, I may not have my degrees, but it's like, but Fred Science is also kind of a joke too, because it's like, Fred's a scientist? Like, what do you mean, right? That's the joke. Like, but yet you talk to me, and I'm pretty technical. I'm very particular and technical, and I got a lot of, like, I don't know, you know what I mean? I don't know everything well, but I know a little bit about a lot of things in the world of science, but not, and dude, these people in the Y sauna, oh, this is, you weren't there for this, but They misunderstood what I was saying, and this one dude was trying to tell me, like, I can't learn what someone going through college, well, like a PhD, not a PhD, but he said, I can't know what a science student can know, unless, he says, like, he told me, like, you can't get this stuff from internet, he's like, you can't get this stuff from internet, the videos, I'm like, well, I tried to challenge him, and I'm like, well, who says I can't get this from the internet? I'm not saying the internet should be the only source, but there's so much information that we can all access, regardless of our status, but this guy was trying to say, like, that I have to be at a college, like a real legitimate college, doing lab experiments. And these are the people who unfortunately don't understand that just living in the world and looking at nature and, like, talking to people and just making connections through the little bit of science that you may know, this thing, that is enough. It's not enough, but you can learn, you know how much science, you know how much quote-unquote science I've learned just from looking at the patterns of nature, like, just walking around and looking at where, how the water's flowing and how the trees are doing and picking the berries, can you think of a more scientific experiment than kids picking berries, like, in the summer? Like, you know what they call them, labs? What are they called? Experiments in labs, right?
Mm-hmm.
What's a better lab experiment than watching a little bush starting to get buds on them, then growing flowers, and then watching the bees come, pollinate those flowers, and then getting the fruit? That's what they should be doing in all schools in elementary. They should be taking the kids out there all throughout the season, and then by the end of the school year in June, when the first berries are ready, the kids could start watching them from like the winter. And by the way, Jacob, speaking of on touch with education there, not all the schools are fucked, and then all the schools have a bad system, because believe it or not, there are
There's always exceptions.
There's always exceptions. There's two types of schools called Montessori schools, and believe it or not, you may know someone that went to one, because there's one that used to be in Shrewsbury, and there are some throughout the East Coast. You know what's ironic? Like, Massachusetts and New England and the Northeast and the East Coast, like, we're so known for colleges. Like, and there still really are so many. Dude, you know LSD? You know fucking LSD was synthesized? Now I may have my thing about LSD because it's synthetic, although it does come from wheat. Ergot. You know about that?
I know all about it, yes.
Yeah, of course. So Timothy Leary was born in Springfield, right near my mentor, right over there in the Connecticut River Valley, near the Appalachians, going there too, sort of-ish, Connecticut South. They did the, do you know how I told you we have to go to the health food store? You've only been to Living Earth, right? You haven't been to Roots yet. You haven't been to Deborah's Natural Gourmet. You haven't been to, oh my, you haven't been to the one right near.
You gotta text me all those names that you just said.
Well, go there, Jacob. This isn't a seasonal thing. I mean, it's best. Oh man, when you go to Living Earth, if you ever went to Living Earth in June, oh my God, in June, July, the produce they have is it's literally all local, like in July, like all the vegetables. Now, if only that farm didn't kill animals, but what can I do about that, man? Like, you know, if you want to get really anal, it's like only buying vegan
products.
But
that's when it comes down to being quote-unquote picky.
Yeah, picky, or also good, better, best. Like, by the way, we're already talking about 50,000 things, literally 50,000, maybe not 50,000, but at least 50. And then 50,000 in the total of our conversations, even though we haven't had 1,000 conversations, but you know, overall. I also want to send you each person whose YouTube channel, there is a video I'm in. I'm in a video that got like 25,000 views. I'm in there for like 3 seconds. It's me talking. It's me not shutting up about something right in front of the beach. I'll show you that video. But I met this guy, John Kohler. You know, look this guy up right now. You said you want to grow sprouts? Look up this guy, John Kohler. Super excited, passionate guy about gardening, raw veganism. This dude is almost 50 years old, and he looks 30, just like Marcus Rothkranz. He grows all his own vegetables. He has two YouTube channels. Okay, Raw. Yes, I'll send these to you, or we'll just, when I go to your house, you write them down, or we'll find them. Okay, Raw. And then the other one is Growing Your Greens. Growing Your Greens. Very catchy, right? Growing Your Greens. And he shows people all organic farming. He knows his shit. He knows his stuff. I mean, I wish I met him sooner. No, I wish I was doing this stuff sooner so that I could have, because I was in an airport ride with this kid. He was the first. No, what am I saying? Kid, he's 50. He doesn't have children, and his girlfriend was 16 years younger than him. And me and her got along great, but I guess they broke up. But they were still friends or something. I don't know.
16 years, damn.
Huh? Yeah, 16 years, I know. I mean, my parents is 5, that's not a big deal. I mean, I'm troubled when I look at a girl your age, but then again, I really shouldn't second guess. I mean, I know we're all after high school now, whatever, but to me, it's just like the cultural dilemma, the generational dilemma. It's not even like, I'm not going to deny that of course I can still be attracted to, God forbid, a 17-year-old, but I mean, I'm not going to do anything. But it's like, then again, my sister's 18, you're 19, some girls 18, 17. I mean, I know it all cancels out in the future, whatever, like, but then again, is it really okay for a 50-year-old to be with a 20-year-old? No, it's not. You know what I mean? You know, people are so caught up
in the concept. It doesn't matter what you believe in. It matters how you use your belief system, and you can't, as long as they're not hurting anybody.
I know, dude, you're right
about what they're doing.
I know
there's so much shit that we have to focus on. We can't get sidetracked on who's doing what. Like,
no gossip. No, I'm not trying to know, dude. I'm not even trying to be mean.
I know what you're not trying to do, but we gotta realize what matters. We gotta ask ourselves what really matters in this.
Everyone does to themselves, right? And hopefully they're, and by the way, Jacob, and the word you're looking for, and this is what also made me really put me in check, when you keep talking about how, you know, all your disappointment of humanity, and it's like, not your disappointment, but like how it's come to and what it is, here's the word for it. Ego. Yeah, and not ego versus eco too, but it's bio. So here's two terms I'll teach you that are real scientific terms, quote-unquote scientific: biocentricity and ethnocentricity. Bio, again, means life. Ethno means human or people. And so anthro means human, anthropology, I think. The ethnicity, people. So biocentricity, so break it down. What do you think that means? Biocentricity, biocentric. Is life...
Centricity reminds me of synchronicity.
No, don't think about that going. No. True, they both have the icity, but center, centra, middle, circle, full circle, central. Think of central. Central is a central area. Central is like the town central. Worcester central, Worcester center, Leicester center, the middle. So biocentricity, centricity is the state of being in a circle. So biocentricity means life is in the center. Life. So life matters for everyone. So like all of life matters. Whereas humans have fucked up by being ethnocentric. Ethno means humans matter first. So too many people have lived in a way that, no, it only matters for the humans. So ethnocentricity is how, like, we're justifying destroying animals, killing animals, destroying their habitats, destroying their homes, rape, you know, colonialism in general, really, but that's not really with other, that's with other humans, but that's a whole other problem. But, like, that was before, it's kind of irrelevant now. But ethnocentricity is thinking that, you get it? Ethnocentricity is everything you're saying. People don't know better, they're hypnotized, they're conditioned by all this, they think that we're the most important, we're selfish. That all goes back to the idea that ethnocentricity, that humans are more important. So it's almost like saying God only put humans in the world, when no, God put all these creatures, all these plants, all these, everybody, as if, don't you think, how arrogant, right? And dude, I gotta show you the lecture every Jew must watch. Even though you're not a Jew, this is a guy who calls out all the, he's a big vegan, he's a big animal rights advocate, and he goes around Israel, even though Israel already has a 10% population of vegans in the city of Tel Aviv, apparently the city of Tel Aviv, dude, you know, Jacob, you can't deny I'm pretty blessed, right? The fact that I've been in like a biblical territory, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
like
that's,
I've been
amazing.
Like, don't you agree? Like, I've seen the Qumran caves, I swam in the Dead Sea.
I was blessed to go to Japan. That place is sacred as fuck.
You were in Japan, I thought.
Yes, for 3 years.
But you're so, exactly, you mean go back. No, every place is sacred. Just think about that. Yeah, every place is sacred. But I'm saying, like, the Dead Sea, there's nothing like the Dead Sea anywhere in the world. You go in and
there's nothing like any place anywhere in the world. Think about that.
That's true. That's true. You're right. Well, there's always, and that's an amazing, like, even, we have so much, I mean, nothing like Appalachia, nothing like, what's the tallest mountain?